Hello and welcome to the channel. In the last video, we talked about Amblopletus, or the rock bass genus. In this video, we're going to talk about the next genus in the sunfish family, and that's LEPOMIS, or the sunfish genus. There are 13 species in this genus, not including subspecies, so I'm just going to cover LEPOMIS in a very general way. LEPOMIS is Greek, and it means scaled cover. This name refers to the scaled operculum, or gill cover. It has what's called an opercular flap, or lobe. Anglers sometimes call this flap, which is an extension of the gill cover and ear. All 13 species in this genus have very prominent opercular flaps. Mature males are generally brighter than females and have larger, more pronounced opercular flaps. The LEPOMIS genus is the sister genus to the Micropterus, or black bass genus. This means if you go back far enough in time, these two groups shared a common ancestor at some point. Most estimates based on DNA sequence data and fossil evidence suggest LEPOMIS and Micropterus diverged about 25 million years ago. Today, these two groups superficially have very little in common. But all species in LEPOMIS and Micropterus do have three anal fin spines. The three species of Eneacanthus, the banded sunfishes, also have three anal fin spines, but they have rounded caudal fins. But technically, there are three genera with three anal fin spines in the sunfish family: LEPOMIS, Micropterus, and Eneacanthus. If we look at the LEPOMIS genus, it's pretty easy to see how they got the name sunfish. They have a deep and highly compressed body shape. Mature males are also brightly colored. Sunfish, by the way, do have a few different nicknames, the most common being brim and panfish. Panfish being the more generic term that's often applied to any small fish that'll fit into a frying pan. So sunfishes, like all Centrarchids, are freshwater species native only to North America. They have a laterally compressed body shape, and the anal fin has multiple spines. The dorsal fins are fused or broadly connected. The males also construct and guard a nest. And what are some of the characteristics that distinguish sunfishes from other Centrarchids? They have a deep, highly compressed body shape. Most have smaller mouths. The anal fins have three spines. The gill covers have well-developed opercular flaps or lobes. Mature males are brighter than females and have larger opercular flaps. Now, there are currently 13 species in the LEPOMIS genus, not including subspecies, so the first species we're going to talk about is probably one everybody knows because it has such a large distribution, and that's the bluegill sunfish. The first thing I need to mention about the bluegill is there are a few different subspecies, so you're going to find some regional variation between populations. The northern bluegill has the largest distribution, so it's the one most anglers probably think of when they think of a bluegill. When you see a bluegill color crankbait, chances are it's this fish. And they're called northern bluegill because their native range extends north all the way up into Canada. When you look at an adult male northern bluegill, one of the first things you're going to notice is the blue coloration around the head, which gives the fish its name. If you look at the lower jaw, the cheek area, and the outside edge of the gill cover, you can see the blue coloration on this fish. I also need to mention this blue coloration is going to be more obvious on adult males, so you also want to look for these vertical bars on the body of the fish. The fish on the left here is a male, but you can see the vertical bars. They're usually a lot more distinct on females and juveniles, so they're probably going to be one of the first things you notice. Bluegill also have a black or nearly black opercular flap or lobe. Again, these will be larger on males as you can see, but if you look at the edge of the flap, there's no red on the outer margin of the flap. It's all black. And just a couple of other features that are not unique to bluegill, but you may notice a black spot at the base of the soft dorsal fin. On some individuals, this may be more prominent, but bluegill are not the only species with this trait. Green sunfish, for example, also have a dark spot or blotch at the base of the soft dorsal fin. Bluegill also have really long pectoral fins. They're not the only sunfish with long pectoral fins, but this is something you may notice. The pectoral fins are so long, in fact, that if you bend them back towards the eye, the fins will extend past the eye. The next subspecies is the Coppernose Bluegill, which is sometimes called the Florida Bluegill because they're native to the Florida Peninsula and South Georgia from the Suwannee drainage over to the St. Mary's River. The Coppernose Bluegill gets its name from the copper color on the forehead above the eyes. Now, if you've never caught a Coppernose Bluegill, it might look like the fish has some kind of disease, or you might think something tried to eat it because this area can look discolored like the scales have been removed. Coppernose bluegill have most, if not all of the same, physical traits as the northern bluegill, like the blue coloration around the head, but overall they're a lot darker fish, so the other traits are less distinct. And here's an image that shows some of the variation you might see in the coppernose bluegill. The fish on the right has the textbook copper coloration above the eyes. The male on the left is a lot darker, so the copper color is not as distinct. Another interesting thing biologists have found is the range of the coppernose bluegill pretty much mirrors the range of the Florida bass, and this is no coincidence. Phylogenetic studies using DNA sequence data and fossil evidence have shown that coppernose bluegill and Florida bass have similar divergence times. I think one was 2.3 million years ago and the other was 2.8 million years ago. The divergence time is the amount of time that's elapsed since two populations split from a common ancestor. Coppernose bluegill and Florida bass have similar divergence times, so they both split from northern populations around the same time. So what could isolate populations of at least two different species in the Florida Peninsula long enough for them to diverge into separate and distinct groups? How about a global rise in sea level? Because that's exactly what happened leading up to the period when these populations split. We have something called the Pliocene Warm Period, or some call it the Mid-Pliocene Warm Period, because the warm period happened during the middle of the Pliocene epoch. The start of this period varies depending on where you get your info, but somewhere between 4.2 and 3.3 million years ago, and it most likely ended around 2.8 million years ago. The next bluegill subspecies we're going to talk about is the handpaint or hand-painted bluegill, and it's pretty easy to see how it got that name. These fish have dark blotches that look like they were hand-painted with a brush. The size and shape of the blotches can vary, as you can see in this image. These are both males, by the way. I just wanted to show some of the individual variation you might find if and when you target these fish. Handpaint bluegill are native only to the Apalachicola and Chipola River systems. Next we have the eastern bluegill. The native range of the eastern bluegill extends from the Satilla River drainage in South Georgia all the way north to the Yadkin-Pedee River drainage in North Carolina. But there is a zone of introgression with the coppernose bluegill that includes most of South Georgia and part of South Carolina. This means you could find eastern bluegill, coppernose bluegill, or coppernose eastern bluegill hybrids if you're fishing in or near this area. Last but not least, well, actually it is the least or the smallest bluegill subspecies. The southwestern bluegill was native to the central, southern, and western portions of Texas and northeastern Mexico, but introductions of non-native bluegill led to the decline and possible extinction of this subspecies. It's worth mentioning the southwestern bluegill is not universally recognized, and some biologists believe northern bluegill were misidentified when the southwestern bluegill was originally described. So there is some dispute about the status of the southwestern bluegill or if they even exist. This image is a bluegill from West Texas. I don't know if it's a southwestern bluegill, but I thought it was better than having no pick at all. Next is the Redear sunfish, which often goes by the nickname Shellcracker. The name Shellcracker, of course, comes from the fact this fish likes to eat snails, small clams, and mussels. Redear sunfish have even been stocked in some lakes out west to control invasive mussels. Redear sunfish also eat crayfish and any other kind of invertebrates they can find on the bottom. These fish are definitely bottom feeders. I've been bass fishing for over 30 years, and I've never caught a redear sunfish on a topwater lure. I've caught tons of redbreast sunfish and bluegill on topwater lures, even Warmouth and green sunfish, But all the Redear sunfish I've caught while bass fishing came on Texas rigged worms and crankbaits. Because Redear sunfish like to eat things that live on the bottom, they're usually going to be deeper than other sunfish. The Redear sunfish gets its common name from the red coloration on the rear margin of the opercular flap, which many anglers call an ear. Males have bright red on the rear margin of the opercular flap, like the fish on the left. Females usually have smaller opercular flaps, and the rear margin will be orange like the fish on the right. Redear sunfish can have faint vertical bars, similar to the bluegill, like the male in this image on the left. Redear sunfish also have gray, gold, and or bronze spots on the cheek, gill cover, and body that can give the fish a mottled appearance. The belly can be white to yellow or even a light orange. Redear sunfish, like bluegill, have extremely long pectoral fins that extend past the eye when you bend the fin forward. Redear sunfish are the largest members of the LEPOMIS genus. The IGFA all-tackle world record redear sunfish was caught at Lake Havasu in Arizona. It was 17 inches long and weighed 5 pounds 12 ounces. And here's the native range of the redear sunfish. Most sunfish have been widely introduced, and this species is no exception. At some point, I'll do another video that shows the areas the fish have been introduced, but I didn't have time to make separate maps for every fish. But for now, we're going to focus on the native ranges. Okay, next we have the redbreast sunfish. The redbreast sunfish is the type species of the LEPOMIS genus, which means the genus was named after this fish. LEPOMIS means scaled ear, and male redbreast sunfish have well-developed, elongate opercular flaps. You may also notice the opercular flap, in addition to being long and narrow, is all black. There's no other color on the lobe of the flap or the rear margin. The redbreast sunfish gets its common name from the bright red breast and belly on breeding males. This area can be a red color or more orange on some males. On female redbreast sunfish, this area tends to be more yellow. You may also notice the wavy blue lines on the head under the eye. These irregular blue lines are called vermiculations, and they're pretty thin on the redbreast sunfish compared to other species. The margins of the soft dorsal and caudal fin lobes on most redbreast sunfish will usually have some red coloration. The pectoral fins are short and more rounded, so they usually do not extend past the eye if bent forward. Redbreast sunfish also have larger mouths than bluegill and redear sunfish. On a redbreast sunfish, the upper jaw will extend to the eye when the mouth is closed. The larger mouth of the redbreast sunfish generates more suction and allows this species to target larger prey items than bluegill, so anglers often catch this species while bass fishing. Redbreast sunfish are one of the more aggressive members of the LEPOMIS genus and have no problem hitting larger lures for bass. I catch them all the time on Texas rigged worms, buzzbaits, and other topwater lures for bass. Redbreast sunfish are found in lakes, but this fish prefers areas that have current, probably more than any other species in the LEPOMIS genus. Redbreast sunfish max out around 12 inches. The IGFA all-tackle world record weighed 1 pound 12 ounces and was caught from the Suwannee River in Florida. And here's the native range of the redbreast sunfish. Next up is the green sunfish. The first thing you're probably going to notice is the body shape of this fish and or the size of the mouth. The green sunfish is not only a thick-bodied fish, but it has an elongate body shape. When the mouth is closed, the upper jaw extends to the middle of the eye or slightly beyond. Most anglers that have never caught a green sunfish before usually think this is some kind of bluegill largemouth hybrid, but Centrarchids from different genera cannot hybridize. I think they've made some in the lab, but it doesn't happen naturally, or if it has, it's never been documented. So just to recap, the green sunfish is a thick-bodied fish with an elongate body shape and a really large mouth. The only other species in the LEPOMIS genus with this same thick-bodied elongate shape is the Warmouth. Warmouth also have large mouths, so anglers naturally get these two fish mixed up all the time. There are, however, a few easy ways to ID these fish. Green sunfish, first of all, have the wavy blue lines on the head under the eye. Those irregular blue lines are called vermiculations, and you can see they extend across the cheek and the operculum or gill cover. Warmouth, on the other hand, have 3 to 4 dark streaks that radiate out from the eye. Another thing that's really going to stand out on the green sunfish is the orange-yellow coloration on the edge of the pelvic, anal, caudal, and soft dorsal fins. Green sunfish are the only species in the sunfish family with this orange-yellow color on the edge of those fins, so it's something that really stands out. The body color of the green sunfish is generally a brownish-green on the back and sides, with blue scale spots forming horizontal lines on the body that become more irregular near the tail. Green sunfish also have a dark spot or blotch near the base of the soft dorsal fin, similar to the bluegill, and some green sunfish also have a dark spot or blotch near the base of the anal fin. The pectoral fins are short and more rounded, so they usually do not extend past the eye if bent forward. Green sunfish have a black opercular flap, and the edge can be an orange or yellow color with some red. Green sunfish can tolerate a wide range of conditions. They're widespread and often abundant in small to large streams, swamps, and ponds, but are less common in large rivers and reservoirs. Green sunfish do sometimes hybridize with other species in the LEPOMIS genus. It's rare, but it does happen because green sunfish often nest close to other sunfish. So every now and then a female green sunfish will deposit some eggs in the nest of another species. I guess if there was enough wave action or current, some eggs might actually get blown into the nest of another male, but I've never actually read that, but it seems like it could happen. Some pond management companies actually make hybrids and give them colorful nicknames, but hybrid sunfish are not formally recognized. They don't have scientific names, and most biologists just call them mutts. Green sunfish max out around 12 or 13 inches. The IGFA all-tackle world record weighed 2 pounds, 2 ounces and was caught from Stockton Lake in Missouri. And here's the native range of the green sunfish. As you can see, it covers a wide area. Like many fish, its natural range has been expanded by stocking and accidental introductions. Okay, next is the warmouth. And I did that on purpose because the warmouth and the green sunfish are both thick-bodied fish with an elongate body shape. They're the only species in the LEPOMIS genus that have this thick-bodied, elongate shape, almost like a bass. Warmouth and green sunfish also have the largest mouths in the LEPOMIS genus, so they do hit larger lures that are typically used for bass. The larger mouth size generates a lot of suction. This allows the warmouth to ambush prey from a stationary, concealed location. Anglers often catch warmouth and green sunfish on Texas-rigged worms and other soft plastics while bass fishing. The upper jaw on the warmouth should extend to or slightly beyond the middle of the eye when the mouth is closed. Warmouth also have a small patch of teeth on the tongue that you should be able to feel with your index finger. As an angler, one of the first things I usually notice when I catch a fish is the head, probably because that's where the fish is hooked most of the time. We've already talked about the size of the mouth and the patch of teeth on the tongue. Warmouth also have 3 to 4 dark streaks that radiate out from the eye. As you can see in this image, the body coloration of the warmouth can vary a lot depending on factors like age and sex of the fish, season, water color, the type of water, the environment where the fish was caught, and the cover where the fish was holding. There may even be some regional variation in color. So not only can the body coloration vary a lot on the warmouth, but some fish will have faint vertical bars, while others have a more mottled appearance. But one thing that doesn't change are the 3 to 4 dark streaks that radiate out from the eye. You can see those dark streaks on just about every fish in this image. Green sunfish have the wavy blue lines called vermiculations, so this is an extremely reliable way to ID the warmouth. And rock bass have more anal fin spines. They have 5 to 7 spines, while sunfish only have 3 spines. But let's say you forget how many anal fin spines each genus has. By the way, an easy way to remember the number of anal fin spines, there are 3 genera with 3 anal fin spines. LEPOMIS and the sister genus Micropterus, and the other one is the banded sunfish genus. And they're so small, you're probably never going to catch one unless you actually target them, because the banded sunfishes are the smallest members of the sunfish family. All other genera in the sunfish family have more than 3 anal fin spines. But if you do happen to forget how many anal fin spines each genus has and you don't have a smartphone, there's another way you can ID these fish. Warmouth have 3 to 4 dark streaks that radiate out from the eye like rays of the sun, and warmouth are members of the sunfish genus. Rock bass, on the other hand, have a single streak below the eye that comes down at an angle. Every species in the rock bass genus has this single streak. It's not always super distinct, and the water color or the conditions can have a lot to do with that. But I think we can all agree rock bass are pretty dull compared to warmouth and other species in the LEPOMIS genus, especially when we look at the coloration on the head. I like to say rock bass have rock heads, or the coloration on the head around the cheek and gill cover is kind of dull like a rock. Warmouth have dark streaks that radiate out from the eye across the cheek and gill cover, like rays of the sun. And warmouth are members of the sunfish genus. Rays of sun, sunfish genus. Anyway, that's something I came up with. Maybe it'll help, maybe not. Warmouth and rock bass rarely frequent the same areas, so I've probably gone down this rabbit hole far enough. By the way, the opercular flap on warmouth will be mostly black, but adult males can have some red on the rear margin of the flap. Warmouth max out around 12 or 13 inches. The IGFA all-tackle world record weighed 2 pounds, 7 ounces and was caught from Guest Lake in Florida. And here's the native range of the warmouth. They're pretty widespread, but are more common in low-gradient streams, sloughs, and other backwater areas with little or no current. Warmouth are also found in ponds and lakes. They seem to thrive in areas with low oxygen levels, where other sunfish species cannot. Next, we have the longear sunfish, but first, there's considerable variation throughout the range of the species, and experts believe there could be several subspecies, but the total number and exact range of each remains unclear. Now, the common name of this fish is kind of misleading, because male redbreast sunfish actually have the longest opercular flaps or ears in the LEPOMIS genus. The scientific name of the longear sunfish is LEPOMIS megalotus, and the specific name megalotus actually means large ear, which is more appropriate because male longear sunfish probably have the largest opercular flaps by surface area. On most longear sunfish, you're going to find the most impressive aspect of the opercular flap is usually not its length, but its width. Male longear sunfish have the widest opercular flaps in the genus. They're also longer than every other species but one, the redbreast sunfish. Again, you're going to find some variation in the size and shape of the opercular flaps, but for the most part, there doesn't seem to be as much variation in the color of the flaps. On a longear sunfish, the opercular flap will be horizontal and mostly black, but the leading edge is often a vibrant blue, which fades to a pale white margin. Like other species in the genus, male longear sunfish have larger flaps than females. Longear sunfish also have the wavy blue lines on the head. Even the upper and lower jaw have this vibrant blue coloration, which resembles lipstick. And we've already talked about this, but those irregular blue lines are called vermiculations, and you can see they begin on the snout of the longear sunfish. The longitudinal blue lines continue under and around the eye, extending across the cheek and the operculum or gill cover. And usually on a longear sunfish, the vermiculations are thicker and more distinct. On breeding males, the bottom half of the operculum, breast and belly, will be a bright orange-red color. The exact shade and its intensity varies between populations, but longear sunfish are often considered one of the most colorful members of the LEPOMIS genus. Coloration on the body can also vary between populations. Breeding males often have numerous blue spots on the back and sides of the body that can give the fish a mottled appearance with faint vertical bars. The pectoral fins on the longear sunfish have an intermediate size and shape. You can't really see the pectoral fins in this image, but they're actually more rounded. Longear sunfish max out around 10 inches. The IGFA all tackle world record weighed 1 pound 12 ounces and was caught from Elephant Butte Lake in New Mexico. And here's the native range of the longear sunfish. While they are found in some reservoirs, longear sunfish are more common in small to large creeks and rivers. Compared to other species in the LEPOMIS genus, longear sunfish are better at obtaining food in moving water. They seem to prefer pool habitats that have a clean sand or gravel bottom with some rock or wood cover. Next, we're going to talk about the northern sunfish because it looks a lot like a longear sunfish, and it was actually considered a subspecies of the longear sunfish until 2013 when it was designated as a full species by the American Fisheries Society. The best way to ID the northern sunfish is to look at the opercular flap. It should be angled upward at a 45 degree angle, while the opercular flap of the longear sunfish will be horizontal. On the northern sunfish, the opercular flap is mostly black and the leading edge is a vibrant blue, which fades to a pale white margin. Northern sunfish also have a prominent bright red blotch on the rear margin of the opercular flap. Longear sunfish also have black opercular flaps, and the leading edge is a vibrant blue fading to a pale white margin. But longear sunfish typically do not have a prominent red blotch on the rear margin of the flap. It should be a mostly pale white color, but males can have some faint red-orange coloration on the rear margin. Northern sunfish also have the wavy blue lines called vermiculations on the head. They begin on the snout, just like we saw in the longear sunfish. The longitudinal blue lines also continue under and around the eye, extending across the cheek and the operculum or gill cover, again, just like the longear sunfish. The upper and lower jaws also have the vibrant blue coloration, just like the longear sunfish. The bottom half of the operculum, breast, and belly will also be a bright orange-red color on breeding males. Breeding male northern sunfish also have numerous blue spots on the back and sides of the body that can give the fish a mottled appearance with faint vertical bars. The pectoral fins on the northern sunfish have an intermediate size and shape. You can't really see the pectoral fins in this image, but they are more rounded. Northern sunfish are also a lot smaller than longear sunfish. They max out around 5 inches, and they're actually one of the smallest members of the LEPOMIS genus. While there is some range overlap with the longear sunfish, the northern sunfish is truly a northern sunfish with a fairly limited distribution that is generally restricted to southern Ontario and the upper Midwest in the Great Lakes and Hudson Bay drainages. Northern sunfish are often found in clear, low-gradient streams and lakes with gravel to sandy bottoms. When we look at the native range of the northern sunfish around the upper Midwest and the Great Lakes region, we can see they're primarily found in the streams that flow into Lake Michigan, Lake Huron, and Lake Erie. Next, let's look at the dollar sunfish, because this is another fish that's often confused with the longear sunfish. The opercular flap, once again, is going to be the most useful characteristic for separating this fish from the longear sunfish. As you can see, the opercular flap on the dollar sunfish is angled upward. It's also mostly black, but has blue-green spots and short wavy lines or vermiculations on the black portion of the opercular flap. The dollar sunfish is the only member of the LEPOMIS genus that has spots and vermiculations on the black part of the opercular flap. The leading edge of the flap can be a vibrant blue or light green, which fades to a white or silver margin. Some believe the dollar sunfish gets its name from the shiny white to silver appearance of the margin, which resembles the color of a U.S. silver dollar. The dollar sunfish is another species where you're going to find some regional variation, as you can see in this image. Dollar sunfish coloration can vary between some populations, so I'm not spending much time on it. The dollar sunfish looks a lot like the longear sunfish. As you can see, the head is covered with wavy lines or vermiculations, which can be a vibrant blue or a white-silver color. They begin on the snout and continue under and around the eye, extending across the cheek and the operculum or gill cover. The bottom half of the operculum, breast, and belly is often a bright orange-red color on breeding males. Breeding males also have numerous blue spots on the back and sides of the body that can give the fish a mottled appearance with faint vertical bars. The pectoral fins on the dollar sunfish have an intermediate size and shape and are more rounded. And here's the native distribution of the dollar sunfish. As you can see, this fish is found along southern Atlantic coastal drainages from North Carolina to Florida and west to Texas. The dollar sunfish is most abundant in streams below the fall line. And what do we know about streams below the fall line? These are low gradient streams for the most part, flowing across the coastal plain, which is mostly sand, silt, and clay. So you have lateral channel movement from erosion. This lateral channel movement over time creates sloughs and oxbow lakes. That's where you're going to find the dollar sunfish. They like slow-moving, small to large streams, floodplain pools, swamps, and oxbow lakes, but they are found in some man-made reservoirs. Dollar sunfish can be found in areas that have a sand or silt bottom covered with organic debris like detritus, which usually comes from submerged aquatic vegetation. In creeks and rivers, dollar sunfish prefer pools with little or no current. Areas with cover, especially fallen trees, are prime habitat for this species. Dollar sunfish max out around 5 inches. They have small mouths and eat mostly midge larvae and microcrustaceans. If I had to compare them to another species, dollar sunfish are kind of like a southern version of the northern sunfish. Okay, next we're going to check out the pumpkinseed sunfish, which gets its name from the pumpkinseed shape of the body. This body shape, by the way, is not unique among sunfish. The pumpkinseed just happened to be one of the first members of the LEPOMIS genus to be described by science. The scientific name of the pumpkinseed sunfish is LEPOMIS gibbosus, and the specific name gibbosus actually means humpbacked, which describes the prominent forehead male sunfish often develop as they mature. Other sources claim the pumpkinseed sunfish gets its name from the irregular brown to gold spots that cover its body. These spots do resemble pumpkin seeds. As you can see in this image, the head is covered with the wavy lines or vermiculations, which can be a vibrant blue or teal color over a golden brown to olive background. They begin on the snout and continue under and around the eye, extending across the cheek and the operculum or gill cover. By the way, the wavy lines or vermiculations on the pumpkin seed can radiate out from the mouth and eyes like the fish on the right, or they can be more irregular like the fish on the left. So don't let that throw you off if you happen to catch one like that. The opercular flap on the pumpkin seed is mostly black. The leading edge of the flap can be a vibrant blue or light green, which fades to a white margin. And males will have a prominent red blotch on the rear margin of the opercular flap. The pectoral fins on the pumpkin seed are long and pointed. If you bend the fins back towards the eye, they will extend past the eye. Like other species in the LEPOMIS genus, body coloration is seasonal and can vary between populations. Males and females look different, and the markings can change as fish grow from juveniles to adults. So that's why we're not spending a lot of time on body coloration. The wavy lines or vermiculations on the head, the colors on the opercular flap, and the irregular brown to gold spots are really all you need. The pumpkinseed is the only species in the LEPOMIS genus with this combination of traits. I'm also trying to keep the ID process relatively simple and easy to remember so you can actually use it when you're on the water. The native range of the pumpkinseed extends north from the Edisto River drainage in South Carolina up the east coast to New Brunswick and includes the Great Lakes, Hudson Bay, and upper Mississippi drainage systems. Pumpkinseed sunfish have been widely introduced in other states and Europe, where they're considered an invasive species. They live in a wide range of habitats, from slow-moving creeks and rivers to the shallow areas of lakes. Pumpkinseed sunfish prefer areas with submerged vegetation and wood cover. They can tolerate a wide range of environmental conditions, including acidic swamps and slightly brackish creeks and rivers. Pumpkinseed sunfish eat small mollusks, insects, and other small invertebrates. Okay, we're going from one of the most colorful sunfish to probably the least colorful one. The spotted sunfish gets its name from the black spots all over the body and the head of the fish. Distinct black scale spots form irregular horizontal rows along the sides and body. Spotted sunfish also have numerous small black spots on the head and gill cover. The opercular flap on the spotted sunfish is relatively short and mostly black. The mouth is an intermediate size, so the upper jaw usually extends to the front of the eye or just beyond it when the mouth is closed. There's also some variation across the range of the species. Some individuals and/or populations of spotted sunfish will have an iridescent blue or turquoise crescent on the lower margin of the eye. You're going to find some populations don't have it for whatever reason, and some do, so don't let that throw you off if you happen to see or catch one like that. The pectoral fins on the spotted sunfish are short and rounded, so they will not extend past the eye when bent forward. The spotted sunfish is native to the southeastern United States. It's found in the Atlantic and Gulf coastal drainages from North Carolina to the Apalachicola River drainage in western Florida. Spotted sunfish can be found in ponds and lakes, but they're most abundant in creeks and small to large rivers below the fall line. This species prefers areas with current and any kind of wood cover like stumps, cypress knees, and logs. The spotted sunfish sometimes goes by the nickname stump knocker because of this preference for wood cover. By the way, the nickname stump knocker gets thrown around a lot in the LEPOMIS genus, but the spotted sunfish is the original stump knocker of the deep south. Spotted sunfish have relatively small mouths and feed primarily on invertebrates that live near the bottom. If you're fishing a Texas rig worm or some other soft plastic for bass, you'll definitely know if any spotted sunfish are around. Most spotted sunfish are going to be around 5 inches long, and they max out around 7 or 8 inches. Next is the red-spotted sunfish, and if you're thinking, hey, this fish looks a lot like a spotted sunfish, you're right. They're closely related, and at one time they were classified as a single species until 1954, when they were split into two subspecies, an eastern form with black spots and a western form with red-orange spots. In 1992, these subspecies were elevated to full species, the spotted sunfish and the red-spotted sunfish. The red-spotted sunfish gets its name from the red-orange spots all over the body and the head of the fish. Distinct red-orange scale spots form irregular horizontal rows along the sides and body. Red-spotted sunfish also have numerous small black spots on the head and gill cover. The opercular flap on the red-spotted sunfish is relatively short and mostly black, but the top margin is often a dark red color, while the lower edge is usually pale white. The mouth is an intermediate size, so the upper jaw usually extends to the front of the eye or just beyond it when the mouth is closed. There's also some variation across the range of the species. Some individuals and/or populations of red-spotted sunfish will have an iridescent blue or turquoise crescent on the lower margin of the eye. You're going to find some populations don't have it for whatever reason, and some do, so don't let that throw you off if you happen to see or catch one like that. Red-spotted sunfish may also have a colorful orange patch just above the opercular flap. The pectoral fins on the red-spotted sunfish are short and rounded, so they will not extend past the eye when bent forward. The red-spotted sunfish is native from the Mobile Basin in Alabama west to central Texas, and in the Mississippi Basin north to the Illinois River. There is an area of introgression where the range of the red-spotted sunfish and the range of the spotted sunfish kind of overlap. It extends from the Perdido River, which forms the Alabama-Florida state line, east to the Apalachicola drainage. The Apalachicola River comes out of Lake Seminole. It actually forms under Lake Seminole where the Chattahoochee and Flint River converge. Anyway, inside this contact zone, they find mostly hybrids, so it's going to be difficult, if not impossible, to get a positive ID without genetics if you happen to be in that area. Here's a map that shows this contact zone in red. On the west side is all red-spotted sunfish, and on the east side it's all spotted sunfish. Red-spotted sunfish are often found near dense vegetation, stumps, and logs. Like the spotted sunfish, anglers sometimes call red-spotted sunfish stump knockers because they're often found near some kind of wood cover, usually cypress tree stumps or knees. Red-spotted sunfish are found in some ponds and lakes, but they're most abundant in swamps, sloughs, oxbow lakes, slow-moving lowland creeks, and small to large rivers below the fall line. Red-spotted sunfish have relatively small mouths and feed almost exclusively on small invertebrates that live near the bottom. Most red-spotted sunfish are going to be around 5 inches long, and they max out around 7 or 8 inches. Next is the orange-spotted sunfish, which despite its name and appearance, is actually more closely related to the bluegill. The orange-spotted sunfish gets its name from the bright orange-red spots on the head and sides of the males. Females have brownish-orange spots. Most orange-spotted sunfish have a greenish back and sides with a yellowish breast and belly. Spawning males have a bright orange-red breast and belly, and the head turns an iridescent blue color with vivid orange-red spots and streaks on the gill cover. In this image, you can see the difference. We've got a regular male orange-spotted sunfish on the left and a male with spawning colors on the right. The opercular flap is black with a distinct white border on both fish. The pectoral fins of the orange-spotted sunfish are short and rounded, so they do not extend past the eye when bent forward. The pelvic and anal fins also have a black fringe. The native range of the orange-spotted sunfish covers a wide area, including the Great Lakes and Hudson Bay drainages, the Mississippi drainage, and Gulf Coast drainages from Alabama to Texas. Orange-spotted sunfish are found in ponds, lakes, and some reservoirs, but they're most abundant in swamps, backwater sloughs, oxbow lakes, slow-moving lowland creeks, and small to large rivers. Orange-spotted sunfish seem to prefer extremely turbid or muddy water that is not suitable for other species. They can tolerate a wide range of temperatures and water that is low in oxygen. We're talking about shallow stagnant water with dense aquatic plant growth where the bottom is mostly mud, silt, and detritus from dead plant material. Orange-spotted sunfish primarily feed on small crustaceans, aquatic insects, and zooplankton, but few anglers actually target them because of their small size. Most orange-spotted sunfish are going to be 3 to 4 inches long, and they max out around 5 or 6 inches. Last but not least, well, actually, it is the least because the Bantam sunfish is the smallest member of the LEPOMIS genus. It's also the least studied and the least understood. The Bantam sunfish lacks bright coloration and is usually a dark color with around 10 vertical stripes or bands. Spawning males often have numerous yellow spots that form irregular rows along the sides of the body. The head is mostly dark, but spawning males can develop blue-green spots on the cheek and gill cover. The opercular flap is black with a mostly white border, but spawning males can have some light red-orange to yellow coloration on the bottom and rear margin of the flap. Bantam sunfish have clear to dusky colored fins. There's a dark spot or blotch at the base of the soft dorsal fin that fades with age and may be absent on some large adults. The lower jaw of the Bantam sunfish protrudes beyond the upper jaw. The pectoral fins of the Bantam sunfish are short and rounded, so they do not extend past the eye when bent forward. Adult Bantam sunfish have a robust, symmetrical shape. And here's the native range of the Bantam sunfish, which occurs from the Biloxi River drainage in Mississippi west to the Colorado River drainage in Texas. The Bantam sunfish is also found in the Mississippi drainage all the way up to southern Illinois. Bantam sunfish are found in ponds, lakes, and some reservoirs, but they're most abundant in swamps, backwater sloughs, oxbow lakes, bayous, slow-moving lowland creeks, and small to large rivers. Bantam sunfish seem to prefer areas that are not suitable for other species. They can tolerate slightly acidic water that is low in oxygen. Shallow, stagnant backwaters with dense aquatic plant growth, where the bottom is mostly mud, silt, and detritus from dead plant material. Bantam sunfish are often found in shaded areas with heavy vegetation, stumps, and logs. Bantam sunfish primarily feed on snails, small crustaceans, and other invertebrates, including aquatic and terrestrial insects. Few anglers target Bantam sunfish due to their small size. Most Bantam sunfish are going to be 2 to 3 inches long, and they max out around 4 or 5 inches.